Welcome to Berlin Inside Out, the podcast that takes an expert look at how Germany sees the world and the world sees Germany, with me, Benjamin Tallis.
And me, Aaron Gash Burnett.
Welcome back to Berlin Inside Out, the foreign affairs podcast that takes an expert look at how Germany sees the world and the world sees Germany, in association with the German Council on Foreign Relations. I'm Benjamin Tallis, Senior Research Fellow here at the Council, and I'm here with my friend and co-host, Aaron Gash Burnett, a journalist specializing in German politics. Now, today, we're looking at an especially key relationship, but also a very difficult partnership for Germany, the one it has with Poland. In fact, this relationship between Warsaw and Berlin has been perhaps never so important to get right as it is now. Never had the stakes been so high, but also has the difficulty been so great, given the substantive disagreements between the two countries. Yet, Poland's election seems to have opened a chance for a new start, a reboot of this key relation. Poland's economy is growing fast, one of the fastest rates in the EU, 6.8% in 2021. And because Warsaw has taken such a leading role in responding to Russia's invasion of Ukraine, it carries significant diplomatic, political and military weight, not to mention the large military rearmament that Warsaw is undertaking. Yet in the past, the relationship has been coloured by disagreement, particularly spurred also by the tone that was taken by the PIS, Law and Justice government in Poland, but also by German lack of recognition of Poland's concerns. But beyond that, there's also a lot of historical baggage, isn't there, Aaron?
That's right, Ben. Warsaw and Berlin are only about a 5.5-hour train ride from each other, but they often feel worlds apart diplomatically and politically. The German ambassador to Poland may well have one of the hardest jobs in the German Foreign Service, given the tense negotiations and dialogue that has characterized the German-Polish relationship for years. A previous German ambassador to Poland, Arndt Freitag von Loringhoven, who served from 2020 to 2022, had his appointment delayed, actually, by Warsaw, because he was the son of a Wehrmacht officer who served in Hitler's bunker. Right from the get-go, things were tense. Things weren't much better when he left, either, as he said that the right-wing Law and Justice Party that you mentioned, PIS, which has governed Poland since 2015, couldn't decide if Germany was an ally or a scapegoat. But PIS also provided Berlin with a scapegoat of its own. As long as the right-wing populists were in power in Poland, it was easy for Berlin to discount the substance of the Polish argument on things like the need for Germany to re-engage with Central and Eastern Europe more broadly, step up on defense, or back Ukraine to the hilt. We've seen that come into focus recently. But Ben, we did have elections in Poland recently, which saw both record turnout and former European Council President Donald Tusk emerge with the very real possibility of being able to lead a coalition that would be able to oust the right-wing Law and Justice Party from power. And there's plenty of evidence to suggest the Polish foreign policy argument is going to remain essentially the same on a lot of fronts, isn't there?
Well, that's what we're going to hear more about from our expert guests today. But in some ways, we can see this might be very likely because the demands that Warsaw had on defense, on Germany doing more for European security, on taking a leadership role that took account of allies' views, allies' perspectives, not least on Russia, that's going to stay the same. In terms of getting geoeconomics right, not exposing ourselves to too much risk, then exporting that risk to Germany's partners in Central Eastern Europe, who are deeply involved in German supply chains and value chains, that's going to stay the same too. And also because of the way that election campaign went, with the peace government trying to paint Donald Tusk's party as the pawns of Berlin, certainly Tusk won't have much room for maneuver for giving anything easily to Berlin. So I think both from the politics of it, but also the substance, there's not going to be necessarily so much a change. Where there would be change would be in the tone of the relationship. It wouldn't be voiced in quite the same ways. So with that said, let's turn over to our guests for today. We're delighted to welcome Kai Olaf Lang from the SWP, Jakub Jaroszewski from Democracy Reporting International, and Justyna Gotkowska from the Center for Eastern Studies in Warsaw, who's joining us in a room today in Berlin. Welcome to Berlin. The other two joining us online.
One of our previous guests on the show, Oliver Moody, mentioned that within 30 seconds of talking to most Polish foreign policy experts, they'll bring up Germany. Economically, it's easy to see why. Around 29% of its exports go to Germany. It gets around 20% of its imports. inputs from Germany. That's by far on both counts the highest percentage for Poland, but there's obviously World War II and Nazi Germany's conduct in Poland, for which the Polish government has, or the current one at least, has demanded further financial reparations from Germany, an issue that Germany says they consider closed. Poland, though, continues to demand over €1 trillion from Germany, at least this current government does. That's around a quarter of annual German GDP. But there's also a huge other dimension here, and that is military cooperation. Poland, as Ben was just mentioning, is in the middle of a huge rearmament, one that Berlin isn't always so keen on, despite the fact that Poland is the major frontline state between NATO and Russia. That is a role that West Germany used to have during the Cold War. So can we get a sense of what is Poland doing? Why are they doing it? Why is that so important? And what explains Berlin's reaction to it?
Thank you for the invitation, first of all. Answering the question on security and defense policy, what Poland is doing, I think that, first of all that almost all projects, especially with regard to modernization and reform that were started by the previous government, I think in a large extent, to the large extent, that they will be continued. Because across the political environment in Poland, Russia is clearly perceived as the threat number one. Ukraine war is perceived as directly affecting Poland, and the outcome of this war will be crucial for the Polish security. So Poland feels directly threatened by Russia and feels the need to arm itself to deter a possible attack, a Russian attack, or to defend itself in cooperation with its allies. So the clear priority right now is to rearm itself due to large amounts of military equipment and arms being delivered to Ukraine. So the priority is, and I think this is widely understood, to fill in the stocks, to fill in the units with tanks, with infantry fighting vehicles, with long-range artillery, with fighter aircraft to be able to face up a possible aggressive Russia that might re-emerge in a couple of years even stronger, depending on how the war in Ukraine will end.
Right, that's it. But it's not only been about refilling stocks, it's building back more and building back better on those supplies. I mean, we're talking hundreds of high-level main battle tanks. We're talking hundreds of high-level self-propelled artillery pieces bought from South Korea. We're talking Abrams tanks, so high-end stuff bought from the US, and F-35 fighter jets, HIMARS, the full works, actually, which has required an enormous amount of GDP to be spent on this. High percentages, right?
Yes, that's true. It's not only about refilling the stocks given to Ukraine, it's about strengthening the military. And there will be a question mark over substantial purchases of South Korean equipment, especially. I'm sure that the first phase of the procurement of tanks and artillery systems will be sustained by the future coalition. But the question mark remains over much more substantial cooperation, industrial cooperation, and equipping Polish armed forces with hundreds additional systems. And I think the new government will have to make an audit, a review of where it sees the Polish modernization of the armed forces is going, how much financial means in the coming year and in the next years there will be available for that. There will be a decision on some parts of the modernization programs. But I do believe that much of what has been ordered in the US and the South Korea and elsewhere will be sustained because the priority is clear. I think it's clear for the political parties that we need to have strong armed forces in a perspective of 3, 4, 5 years time, because this is a time frame when Russia can rebuild itself and be a threat towards NATO.
Exactly. So it's preparing for that future. And Kai Olaf Lang, Justina mentioned that this was ordered from South Korea. It's been ordered from the US, it wasn't ordered from Germany, despite Germany's large munitions and arms industry. But also, we haven't heard much praise for it here in Berlin. Poland is undergoing the kind of rearmament that Germany is still talking about doing, and Poland's actually going ahead and doing it. Yet we've mainly heard criticism. This is unstrategic spending, it's too expensive, etc. Why is that? And why does this make Berlin nervous?
Well, I think at the very end, we should add what German interests are. And I think Germany is interested in having Poland, which is an important and a key ally in NATO and a key partner in the European Union, which is strong, which is prosperous, and which is secure. So I think it is good for Germany if Poland, as a pillar on NATO's eastern flank, which invests in its own defense, in its own armaments, in its own armaments industry and capabilities. However, what of course has led to some skepticism, and you pointed at that in Germany, is certainly, I would put it this way, that defense and armaments policy decisions, especially from whom you buy weapon systems, is always also a political signal. There is no doubt that Poland intends to buy high-quality weapons. There is no doubt that the factor of time, who is able to deliver tanks and other weapon systems, also plays an important role. No doubt there are bottlenecks in European countries, including Germany. But at the same time, if you look at the broad spectrum, it is a clear strategic investment, particularly in Polish-American relations, which I understand, because the US is the main security anchor for Poland. I think and kind of security and defense cooperation always also has a sort of economic element, particularly bearing in mind that people like Donald Trump might get back, but also others in the US will look at the security partnership, this new special relationship, which is emerging between the US and Poland, also from a commercial point of view. But I think many in Germany would have wished a sort of more Euro-Atlantic approach, not only in armaments and defense, but also in the broader security policy posture of Poland.
How are we also seeing a little bit, perhaps a hangover from the German debate over sending various weapons to Ukraine? For example, the Leopard 2 tanks come to mind.
The re-export
right now.
Conditions that were put on that by Germany, which right. is blocking in an urgent time to send these things. I mean, certainly that's the impression we got. Also, with the value sharing argument and the technology transfer argument, it seemed as though Poland was going to get a better deal for Poland from the South Koreans than it would from Germany.
Well, ultimately, it took 11 months, for example, for Leopards to end up being sent sort of from start to finish in terms of the German debate. Is there any sense that that is influencing the Polish decision about where to order from or who to order from when it comes to some of these armaments? The fact that, you know, you might have to actually use these later or even re-export them later to Ukraine or to anyone else, and that Germany might drag its feet on this sort of thing? Is it more flexible to order from the Americans and the South Koreans?
Might play a role. That's why I said the factor of time, who can deliver when, is also, of course, important. But I think it's, to be fair, this is not part of the broader, I think, security political debate in Germany. The average observer from the security political community says there is this kind of US preference in Poland, and this kind of projects into armaments and other decision. On the other hand, I mean, the nitty-gritty of defense negotiations, I'm not an expert on that, and of conditions, it works a little bit in both directions. Certainly, there might be some restraint in Poland for German hesitance, which might also later on have implications for what Poland does with its weapon systems. On the other hand, look, there is a Leopard reparation hub in Gliwice, and there were big ambitions of both sides. Now it's going to start in a rather minimalistic version. It's a good project of German-Polish cooperation. But German companies reported that the demands from Polish companies, kind of on the business side, were not so attractive for them. So they kind of downscaled it. So I think this works in both directions in a way, and always plays into the broader security policy situation. I think the bottom line is what comes out of that. And I think here we have both sides have to work on that. I mean, it's important for NATO, for the West, that this key security partnership between Germany and Poland sends the signal to other partners, but also towards Russia and competitors, that it works. So I think we should avoid further Patriot sagas. So if there are sorts of opportunities for cooperation, we should prepare them maybe more diligently.
Is that really a key relationship for Poland? Is Germany a key security partner? And what are the complicating factors in the relationships?
I would like to place a few comments on the industrial cooperation with Germany and how does that look from Polish perspective. I think that for Abrams and K2 choice, there were a few reasons. First reason was the time frame, when Poland could get as quickly as possible new tanks. And that was clearly the US and South Korea that were able to deliver quickly. And Germany back then in 2022, when the decision was made, there was just a purchase from Norway of new Leopard tanks with a delivery date 2030 something. For Poland, that was not acceptable. And then the second reason, we have to go back into the past, and Poland did not have a good experience with industrial cooperation with German companies with regard to the modernization of its older Leopard 2A4 fleet. The process of modernization took 5, 6, 7 years. The deliveries were extremely low. German companies were reluctant to share technology and experience. And then we have to also go back to Poland's strive to participate in the main ground battle tank project, where Germany and France didn't really want third parties like Poland, which would be a big customer of such a system, to take part in industrial part in this project because of industrial, very commercial reasons. And then I think Poland landed with the decision to buy Abrams and K2 tanks. And additional reason was the very reluctance of Germany to deliver equipment to Ukraine in early 2022. And the reasoning back then was, what about when we are at war? How reliable is Germany then? How reliable is the delivery of spare parts material for refurbishment and repair of Leopard tanks? So I think that we will end in Poland with having the Abrams fleet, K2 fleet, and with Leopard 2A4s, the older version, going gradually to Ukraine.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the notion that these weapons might actually have to be used at some point has seemed to be something rather hard to grasp for certain parts of the German defense industry and also the German government. But Jakub, coming to you, is Germany that key security partner for Poland still?
I think that, yes, it is, and it comes from the fact that generally Germany is a key partner from Poland on many dimensions. Economy-wise, it's absolutely a critical relationship. The amount of business that is done both ways is simply staggering. At any given time, there are around 100,000 Polish citizens in Berlin. Half of them are permanent residents, and the other half are migrant workers who are coming in the city to work in various industries. Some of them don't even live in Berlin. They just come in for a couple of days to work and drive back across whole Poland, back to their families. So this is kind of a snapshot of a far more larger background of this relationship and its importance. And I think that Poland has a very important role to play right now, a role in helping to come about a awakening of Europe to the danger posed by Russia and jumpstarting certain processes, which have been overdue for a long time. And I think that a conversation on rearmament, a conversation on capacity of military production, this is something that many Western European countries are doing or should be doing, depending on whom we ask. But when it comes to Germany, I think that this is a very specific situation, because Germany is a country with amazing economic capacity, with absolutely unparalleled output in several key industries, and with also great capacity of its military defense industry. which has been in many ways underused so far. German military production has been mostly for export, and the domestically German military has been underarmed, and the equipment has been falling apart with time. So perhaps this is a moment for Poland, a new, more constructive Polish government, because this relentless anti-German propaganda is pretty much a specialty of only one political party in Poland, which is using it to drum up its support and to galvanize its core base around the idea of Germans being bad and the other Polish politician parties being in cahoots with Germany. So for the new Polish constructive government to work with its partners, including Germany, but also not being shy of being critical and of being there to motivate and goad others, including Germany, to step up on several fronts, one of them being common defense against Russia. And I would very much be happy if a Polish government would be constructive, but this constructivity would also include being able to criticize and to be able to motivate and push things towards a point where we collectively will not have to fear much from Russia, which I believe the European Union is perfectly able of achieving, but some step needs to be taken.
Right, exactly. I mean, so that the hope is that indeed a government led by Donald Tusk would be perhaps an iron fist in a velvet glove rather than the iron fist in the iron glove that we've seen from the Kaczynski-inspired peace government. And so to actually be able to persuade, to seduce a little bit while remaining firm on values. But there is still a gap in geostrategic thinking, isn't there, between Warsaw and Berlin, regardless of who's in charge?
Yes, and I think there will be now hopefully a space for a conversation, which ideally should be also broader. I hope that the Weimar Triangle, the format for cooperation between Poland, Germany, and France, a very important initiative that also has been downplayed over the last 8 years, will also come into view, because it's all connected, and the geopolitics include not only defense against Russia and a proper posture towards China, but it also includes topics such as enlargement of the European Union. And now with this enlargement kind of, in a way, coming back to life with certain internal resistance in the EU, which has persisted for a long time and which has dodged the process being mostly gone, we are looking at unprecedented amount of movement, not only towards existing candidates from Western Balkans, but most importantly towards Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia. And this is also geopolitics, and we can talk about EU being a pure, mostly an economic community, also sharing some values and not a defense pact. And we can confidently say that expanding the EU does not mean that NATO is going to expand as well at the same pace, or that EU member states will start deploying their troops in Chisinau or in Tbilisi. But inevitably, this is a geopolitical move. And here again, we need cooperation, and we need some mutual reinforcement between the big EU member states, in particular, when it comes to providing those new candidates with a clear, predictable pathway towards membership. The negotiations will take years. The harmonization process of law and policy will take years. It's inevitably going to be a long road. But there is a very important role to play for both Poland and Germany, hopefully together in making this happen.
Is there an opportunity for a new sort of negotiation between Warsaw and Berlin?
Yeah, is there going to be a meeting of minds, or is that gap still as large as ever?
I think that you mentioned rightly at the beginning and in your introduction that many of old positions in Warsaw will stay, and there will be divisions and differences in the geopolitical outlook, in the way how the EU should or should not reform itself in combination with enlargement, on migration policy, on economic development. But at the same time, there will be a new opening with the new elections, with the new government, with the new tone of the new government. And despite these differences, we should use these opportunities. I think that there are still divisions with regard to where Ukraine should be in the future European security architecture, how this war should end, where Russia should be in the new European architecture. And we will have these differences displayed quite soon. We will have the NATO summit in Washington, and I doubt whether the Polish position will be changed on the invitation to NATO to be formally issued by NATO at the Washington summit. I don't think that the position with regard to officially denouncing the NATO-Russia Founding Act will change. I don't think that the position on any kind of peace negotiation will change. What we see in Poland and what I see from Polish perspective, a very diversified discussion in Berlin with Minister Pistorius being very close to Polish positions, but with the Chancellery determining the tone. And the Chancellery, I think, have a slightly different view on the very strategic issues for Poland. And we will have, also with the new Polish government, there will be clear differences on that. But I think the issue that was mentioned, the EU enlargement and EU reform, this will still be an issue that will be divisive. Because from what I have heard so far, I cannot predict what the new government, what kind of stance on EU reform there will be. But I think that will be also very conservative and cautious. That will be a challenge to reopen a dialogue between Poland and Germany on these issues, on linking enlargement with EU reform, on thinking about how enlargement shall proceed, whether we shall reform the process, whether shall we stick to the old procedures, or shall we think more innovatively about the future EU enlargement with staged enlargement
differentiated. Sectoral integration,
yeah. Exactly. So these topics will be on the table, and that will not be an easy conversation, in my opinion. And the German government will have it more difficult to discuss these issues with a new Polish government, which will be more open for discussion, but also expecting that Berlin will go into some real negotiations and will give concessions.
Right. Yeah, exactly. We've said that a few times, actually, on other episodes of Berlin Inside Out, that this actually, as much as it presents an opportunity for Berlin, it's going to be very difficult because they can't simply dismiss these demands as those of people they radically politically disagree with or who can be dismissed as far-right lunatics or so on, as they often are in the Berlin discourse. So that, when the substance remains the same, that creates an issue. And also, I mean, Aaron, we were just saying that these things, there are differences on positions. You've seen us outlined a number of them. Kai Olaf, how do you see that? Because one of those key differences is on NATO membership, which a lot of people here in Berlin are still very reluctant about, but which around Europe is coming to be seen as something that actually may have to precede, go ahead of EU membership, because to have that security guarantee in place, to have the reconstruction work, to have Ukraine's reform proceed, you need security, and NATO is the way to provide that. But we know that at the Vilnius summit, Berlin was one of the blockers, Warsaw was one of the proponents. Can that gap be bridged?
Allow me a more fundamental remark on also what has been said so far, and the issue you are pointing at fits into this broader situation. I think we have a sort of dialectics between Germany and Poland very often. And the structural dialectical constellation we had in the last years is about the following. In a way, Germany has been the status quo power in Europe and in the European Union for quite some time, at least until February last year, whereas Poland was the anti-status quo power. What do I mean by that? So Germany, as a status quo power, was very reluctant when it came to a deep overhaul of the functioning of the European Union. Rather, an evolutionary way of doing reforms, if at all, no big deepening, no kind of upgrade of the Eurozone, reluctance towards projects like the banking union and so forth. No enlargement, at least it was not really politically pushed for a long time. And of course, also status quo, prolongation, pragmatic relations and cooperation with Russia. So that was kind of the German predilection for status quo, whereas Poland increasingly got this kind of contesting factor in European affairs. It wanted at least the peace government, wanted to take back control, did a sort of anti-hegemonial containment policy vis-a-vis Germany and France. It wanted to have Ukraine and other Eastern European countries in the EU. So it was pushing for enlargement for many, many years. And of course, it wanted a decoupling of Russia before, long before the war had started. So this was a fundamental difference. What makes things more complicated, if you look at certain policies, it was the other way around. So migration policies, here Germany was pushing for change in the EU. Climate policies, Germany was standard bearer of an ambitious climate policy, at least for quite some time. Germany was very sympathetic, not in the French way, to strategic autonomy, especially in transatlantic relations, especially in the times of Donald Trump. Whereas in all these issues, Poland was more conservative, was more status quo oriented. Now, things have fundamentally changed, and that's kind of the demanding situation after the war. Because now Germany said, of course, we're opening up for the enlargement agenda, but this has to go along with basic reforms, QMV and so on and so forth. And we're now Poland, including the probable new government, will be reluctant. Tusk said something like, we don't want to have an institutional revolution in the EU when he was in Brussels recently. You mentioned, and also I think with the question of NATO enlargement, I think here Germany will act in a more traditional mode, in a way. Security guarantees for Ukraine. Yes, this is conditio sine qua non for reconstruction, for the approximation to the European Union. But NATO membership, yes, but, and only in close coordination with Washington. I mean, that's also one of the effects of what we were witnessing after February last year, this increasing revitalization of Berlin and Washington cooperation. Weimar Triangle, I am very humble. You know, for many years, I followed this. And the Weimar Triangle is a sort of a story of lost opportunities. And there have been many policy papers which described the potential which this trilateral has. There's no doubt. But I think the key to Weimar lies in Paris. I think France traditionally was reluctant to open up the exclusiveness of the Franco-German tandem for others, in this case, for Poland. And Germany was a bit ambivalent. Yeah, there were some interesting aspects, but at the same time, sometimes it used as an excuse. But I think what we will witness in the next months with a new government in Poland is certainly meetings, including the top level, also meetings of line ministries. I think all three countries, including Germany, would like to take advantage of this format in order to maybe not pre-cook, but at least to have a dialogue on this basic issue. Justina mentioned that about EU reforms and enlargement. And I think Paris and Berlin are aware that they have to kind of bring in a voice of Central Europe, particularly Poland, with its more sort of willingness to at least engage in a conversation with Paris.
We've just recorded an episode of Berlin Side Out with Sylvie Kaufmann and Jakob Ross, one of our in-house Franco-German experts. And they do not really see a revitalization of Franco-German relations quite the other way, let's say. And moreover, what they do see is a French rapprochement with Central Eastern Europe, but they don't necessarily see one from Berlin. So that's quite an interesting perspective you put across there.
Of course, Weimar Triangle refers to Paris, Warsaw, and Berlin. And on one hand, we could ask whether Donald Tusk really is going to accept a backseat role to Paris and Berlin. That's one way of asking that question. But I do think that it's a bit more complicated than this. And that is especially the case when we look at NATO membership, for example, which we've just been talking about. Paris and Warsaw, it turns out, are actually much more in favor of Ukrainian NATO membership than Berlin is, who, you know, has decided that it's okay to hide behind Washington and put the kibosh on plans for a rather fast integration of Ukraine into NATO. So is it really as easy as sort of Warsaw kind of coming in between the Franco and German married couple, or is it more complicated than this, where there's a possibility that on certain questions that Berlin risks being isolated from the other two?
Weimar Triangle, I must say I'm more skeptical towards this format, although I think there will be a revitalization of that with more symbolic meetings between Berlin, Paris and Warsaw. But Weimar Triangle has a structural imbalance, between two major European powers and one regional European power, Poland. Warsaw was expected to back German-French proposals within the triangle, and that was on many occasions not acceptable. But of course, this format has a symbolic value, can serve as a coordination format. But coming back to what you mentioned, that the issue is more complicated and interplay between these three actors have recently shown additional formats being created between Poland and France, for example, both countries backing Ukraine membership in NATO, but also within the EU backing, for example, the EU training mission for Ukraine and leaving Berlin in the corner and jointly pushing this mission through and then with Berlin later on joining the endeavor and together with Poland, creating two commands, one in Poland and one in Germany, to train Ukrainian soldiers. It might be interesting to see whether this Franco-Polish cooperation might materialize on different topics. I think that would be desirable because then the dynamic of cooperation, policy development in Europe would change a bit. And I think flexible cooperation, coalitions, is that what we need, at least from middle-sized powers like Poland.
Right, more Europe rather than more France and Germany, masquerading exactly as more Europe. And the question, I guess, comes to be, is Berlin comfortable with others taking the lead at times? Is Paris comfortable with that? Are they comfortable with letting others set the pace, as has been the case with the response to Ukraine? And I think Macron swinging behind the Central Eastern European-led campaign to get Ukraine's EU membership candidacy approved was a crucial moment, because Berlin was still reluctant at that stage. And when France shifted, then Berlin was left with nowhere to go, much like on the training mission. But Jakub, do you think that Poland's new government gives a chance for Poland to actually be more influential because of its more liberal stance?
A couple of things here. So first of all, we talk about Donald Tusk a lot, but we need to be mindful of the fact that the government that will likely end up holding the reins of Poland very shortly will be actually made up of a coalition. And Donald Tusk and his civic coalition is just one part of it. There are two other players, three players in this game. The Third Way, a coalition that finished second in the Polish election with 14% of votes, and it's made up of two parties, the Agrarian Party PSL, traditionalist, pro-European, and very much focused on agrarian matters. And Polska 2050, the new party by Szymon Hołownia, which is difficult to describe. I would say that centrist, Christian, social democrat, but also with bits of green in it. But at this point, currently, a little bit more to the right than Tusk's civic coalition, which became a very big tent of centrist ideas. And of course, then there is the left, which is an amalgam of several Polish left-wing parties and movements, but at its core of itself, it's the social democratic left. So this isn't exactly the same Tusk and Tusk government that was before. So it's a little bit of a more broader stroke than just liberal tendencies. But what I think is, and I would very much be happy if that happened, was that this new government would stop in a way downplaying Poland and punching under Poland's weight. Because a long story is that Poland has been the country which had bought into the narrative of it being a small, poor, and a kind of periphery of Europe, and not realizing its economic, military, and political potential. And while, to the credit of the outgoing Polish government, it has been far more bullish and assertive in several areas in which Poland has been traditionally downplaying itself. The problem is that this government has been also toxic and has been conducting most of its foreign policy for purely for the benefit of domestic audience. So what I would like to see is this new Poland, Tusk 2.0, let's say, led to start punching at or above its weight. And to realize that with our economic potential, that with our military potential, which is expanding, as we've discussed at the beginning of this meeting, and with our current geopolitical position, this is a place where we can start playing a little bit more, I would not say aggressively, but definitely in a way that's more adequate to Poland's potential. So yes, but this would require also a little bit of a change of mindset in Warsaw among the people who will be forming the new government. Some of them have been in this game for a very long time, and they might have a hard time exiting this Poland is still knocking on the doors of Europe mindset and moving into the mindset of Poland being one of the top players in the region. So yes, there is potential. We will see how this plays out, but we also need to be mindful that this is no longer one political party or two political parties. This is a far broader coalition. The civic coalition itself also has kind of shifted from being center-right party into being centrist with also elements of left-wing agenda, I would say. And this will be a different government and this will be a different approach.
Right, that's it. And that move away from some of the neoliberal economics that characterized the previous civic platform government is one of the significant changes, I think, in that constellation of power, partly to do with the left being involved, partly to do with the realization that that's been something of a dead end anyway and was something that hurt the civic platform last time out. But certainly with the Czech example, you had an almost similar case of a two-block, five-party coalition uniting to oust, in that case, the oligarch Andrej Babiš, the anti-politics guy, was as opposed to the right-wing ideologues of peace. But nonetheless, they have managed to hold it together, and they have managed to actually get Czechia punching above its weight on foreign policy for the first time in practically 20 years. So there is a model to look at if you can actually make the coalition work, I think. But Aaron, it's very interesting to hear this. We heard Tomasz Ilves a couple of weeks ago talking about how Poland has done everything to limit its own influence in recent times. And now Jakub is saying that actually the time of shooting ourselves in the foot is over, hopefully.
Well, I mean, that's the big question, right? It's a large coalition. Jakub rightly mentions that it's not simply about Donald Tusk. It's a lot of interests to reconcile. But if there is a common vision that can be made, then yes, obviously there is an opportunity also to reengage the relationship with Berlin.
That's what I wanted to ask Kai Olaf about, exactly that, because Kai Olaf, there has to be recognition on both sides. What does Poland need to do to get a better hearing in Berlin? I mean, there have been serious problems in the past as well. We talked about rule of law. You talked about upsetting the EU status quo and so on. Now that's changed around. But what does Warsaw need to do, and what does Poland need to do more widely to get that better hearing in Berlin?
I would agree. I mean, Polish governments in the last years have consistently bet on the wrong horses. So if you remember, after 2015, the key partners for Poland were the UK, which left the European Union, was Trump, as someone who was not really fond of the EU, or Germany, who lost elections, and the Visegrad countries, particularly the alliance with Hungary on rule of law or migration, which fell apart due to due to Russia's war. So I think a weakness of Poland, by the way, also of other Central European countries, but particularly of Poland in the last years, was it had not really networking power, and it was not able to diversify its network of partners, particularly by finding ways to Berlin and Paris. I always used to say, also, the guys in Platforma and around Tusk, including people like Radek Sikorski, they were not really fans of Germany, especially when it comes to security. But they drew another conclusion. Their conclusion was, we cannot completely trust Germany. And the conclusion of peace was, that's why we have to do containment. The conclusion of Tusk and Sikorski and others were, we cannot really trust Germany, that's why we have to cooperate more, at least where it is possible. So what Poland has to do, to clearly say what the expectations are, and to say which issue areas, which projects might be attractive. Cooperation with Poland, I think, for Germany has an added value because there was this pivot to France in the last years. It's not in Germany's interest to be dependent too much on contacts with France. So also Germany has an interest to have alternative partners, additional partners, counterweights to France or to the south of Europe. Now, just one sentence on what you said before and what colleagues in another podcast said about France and Central Europe. Here I'm a bit cautious, not only because I remember different attempts from Paris to open up to Central Eastern Europe. Sarkozy, for example, traveled to the region and he signed, I think, 7 so-called strategic accords with countries from the region. Nothing came out of that. Yes, there are some overlaps, I think, in, let's say, 2.5 areas, agriculture, between France and Poland especially, yeah, aspects of energy policy, true, nuclear, and aspects of strategic culture, which make it possible for France and Poland, despite, I think, quite different views, strategic views of the world, to do cooperation. However, we have a long list of divergences and discrepancies which will not vanish between France and Poland, France and Central Europe. That is, the level of ambitions or the strategic objective of European defense and the approach to transatlantic relations. That is the question of enlargement. Yes, much has changed in France, but I don't think that a country which maybe was not really an active advocate of the East enlargement 2004-2007 now really wants to push for bringing Western Balkans and other Eastern European countries, because there is a reluctance in Paris that that this will lead to a power shift in the European Union, even more towards the East. Budgetary questions. Then the old issue of Europe has to look not only to the East, but also to the South or to the Middle East. This, the Mediterranean, this discrepancy also will not vanish. And I think this means that there are considerable limitations to a reset in a sort of positive, constructive, collaborative way between France and Central Europe.
On those accords signed by Sarkozy, yes, the Czech-French strategic partnership lay moribund for many years. Nothing was done with it. But not really much has come out of the Czech-German strategic dialogue, to be honest, either. And I think what at least the people we talked to in Paris seem to think that there's been a genuine shift in strategic perspective about actually recognizing that power shift to the East has already happened, and that France needs to capitalize on that at a time when Germany isn't.
I think that we should not think, especially in security and defense, too much about or shape Polish-German relations within the bilateral relationship, because I think we are past the situation where we could strengthen Polish-German ties on a bilateral basis only. We have NATO regional defense plans, and the implementation of them currently ongoing. And this is a wider framework where Poland and Germany, together with all other countries, Scandinavia, Sweden soon, hopefully, Finland, Baltic states, but also UK, France, will need to plug in and to find its place in a wider framework of collective defense operations and collective defense framework. So the same with regard to Ukraine, and maybe not talking right now about Ukraine's membership in NATO, but rather talking about the enhancement of European support for Ukraine, military support for Ukraine, because I think this will be a challenge that we will have to face jointly in the coming months, with the US Congress hesitating or discussing the scope of the overall support for Ukraine, with the new package being possibly delayed, and in part for Ukraine, it might decrease. And that will pose difficult questions for us, meaning increasing European joint military support for Ukraine in the coming months. And here, the Eastern flank countries, Germany, France, UK, will have to find a solution how to handle a very difficult situation. So I think this is not only, we're talking right now not only about, you know, bilateral Polish-German initiatives or projects, we have much larger frameworks where Poland and Germany will have to cooperate, find its place together with other partners.
Right, this is such an important point. That's about getting these teams working properly. It's about the whole team, not just about those
exactly.
two, that tandem there. And that's something we try and think about quite a lot here at the DGAP, here on Berlin Side Out, is getting that teamwork really going. But Aaron, there have been some obstacles to team play, haven't there?
Well, yes. And if we look at Polish domestic politics for a moment, one question that's open up in the air at the moment that we were actually discussing with our previous guest, Oliver Moody, on our episode about the Baltic, is whether the last number of years of law and justice government in Poland has sort of constrained any new government's room to maneuver. This is the big question. What kind of factor do reparations play? Is this something that is actually going to be taken forward as a discussion between Warsaw and Berlin under a new government? How big of a role will that play? How serious of a discussion will that actually be? And if so, can a deal actually be done? And what is necessary for a deal to be done?
I believe that reparations, the whole topic of reparations was played by the peace government purely for domestic audience, which is why it has done a lot in the public relations and marketing sphere on this, including sending reports on damages done by Germany to Poland, to governments around the world, including North Korea, but has not taken any concrete, actually viable steps towards reaching any sort of agreement on this and moving this further. So what I expect is that the new government will recognize that there is a slice of Polish society which expects something to be done about those reparations, and will probably perform some moves such as discussing this with the German government and keeping the item on the agenda, but will definitely not turn it into a blunt instrument to beat Berlin over only for the peace power base to cheer up about. So I believe that this topic will play out significantly differently. And it will be quite easy to see that reparations are pretty much a one-party item, and they are on the menu if peace is in power, and they are not so much on the menu if peace is out.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, it's unlikely we'll see a repetition of last year's scene. By the 3rd of October 2022, German Reunification Day, Foreign Minister Annalena Baerbock visits Warsaw, going to the Warsaw Security Forum, only to be presented with this demand for reparations upon arrival from the Polish government at the time. We're unlikely to see that kind of thing. But Justyna, what role are they going to play going forward?
I think that historical issues in Polish-German relationship will still be important, because I think that there is a feeling in the society about a kind of historical injustice. And with this topic being raised strongly by peace, I think this issue needs to be closed, and by German government showing and engaging in flagship projects that could give a feeling that that Berlin sees that this issue is important, and that Berlin wants to invest also financial means for this topic to be closed. And I see two possibilities to do that. I think that a flagship project needs to be supported by Germany with some historical connotations. And there is an issue on the table of German support for a building, Saxony Palace in Warsaw, a highly symbolic building destroyed by the Germans during the Second World War at the end of the Warsaw Uprising.
And that's in the Ogrodzaski.
That's in the Ogrodzaski.
Saxon garden in the heart of Warsaw,
exactly.
Well worth a visit.
Exactly. And I think from my personal view, one needs a flagship project, joint project in security. And that could be, for example, a joint Polish-German purchase of some major military equipment, like a Patriot battery, for example, like a submarine, where Germany can get involved financially, where can this could be operated jointly or by the Polish side, which could show that Germany cares deeply about the security of Poland, and this is a substantial investment and engagement into enhancing Polish security.
Could that actually happen? What is the likelihood that both Warsaw and Berlin could actually be forthcoming when it comes to this kind of these kinds of approaches, Kai Olaf?
I think history is back on the agenda. I call this rehistorization. So in a way, the Second World War in German-Polish relations now is closer than 10, 15 years ago. What has changed in the narrative of peace was that I think peace was not a big champion of the notion of reconciliation. For peace, reconciliation was rather something which the liberals who wanted to reinforce contacts with Germany after 1989-1990 were pushing. And peace reinvented kind of reconciliation by arguing that the reconciliation is only possible if there is a sort of material compensation, reparations or however you call it. I think that was kind of from a formal point of view, from a legal point of view, for Germany not acceptable. But I think what we will see now is a sort of a more sober dialogue on common history with some gestures from the German side. And I always say that a gesture cannot be imposed on you. You know, it has to come from inside. So the project of having a German-Polish house, a bit of a strange name for a place to remember Polish victims of the Second World War in Berlin, is one of the projects, but there might also be other gestures. So I don't think that history-related issues will hijack the agenda in the next time. I would say these clubs and teams, which we are part of, EU and NATO particularly, they only work if bilateral relations are in a good shape. It's like with any other club. If you have two or three relations in the club which do not work, the whole team spirit will not function. So I think that's something where we have to be aware that Germany and Poland are embedded in a European and a transatlantic context, but this embeddedness is always ambivalent. It brings us closer together, it opens up new opportunities, but it is also a source for squabbles.
Right. I mean, we talked recently also about Timothy Garton Ash's wonderful phrase, a usable past, the uses of history that are made. And I think there's an opportunity for Germans and Poles, as well as others, who can actually take those past grievances and turn them into a project for the future, as Justyna mentioned, in security, but also on cultural and social reparation terms. But just to conclude, Kai Olaf, you mentioned that it's time for a sober dialogue. I remember a particular scene in the wonderful film by Andrzej Wajda, Człowiek ze Żelaza, The Man of Iron, where one of the main characters says two sober Poles could agree on nothing. So can Poles and Germans agree in a sober way, or are some other additional ingredients required for this rapprochement to go forward into the future?
And if so, what ingredients are those?
Suggestions to Berlin Side Out via Twitter,
yeah,
please.
Well, we love those suggestions, but I guess what we're hearing is that something obviously is necessary. A different R word is necessary, potentially. Maybe not reparations, but certainly reconciliation, which is obviously tied up any form of reparation.
So we've heard a lot today about the new opportunities that are opened up for Polish-German cooperation, but also the challenges that adhere to that relationship, not only from inside, but also from outside. And facing some of those challenges together seems to be one of the most productive ways to actually take that relationship forward and to make the wider European and NATO teams work a little bit more as they are supposed to.
And to reconcile, of course, as we've been discussing as well, all of these topics we're going to pick up in the second part of our coverage on German-Polish relations. That episode will be out soon. But in the meantime, Join us again for our look to France, and later, of course, in the season to London, Ottawa, and Washington for our transatlantic look as well at Germany's key relationships and how they need to be reviewed against the backdrop of the German Zeitenwende. Thanks very much, and dziękuję to our guests this week for joining us. Until next time, that is all from Berlin. Auf Wiedersehen and tschüss.
Do widzenia.